Teach me to walk in the light of His love. Teach me to pray to my Father above. Teach me to know to walk in the light.
Teach me to walk in the light. Teach me to walk.
Come, little child, and together we'll His commandments that we may return home to His presence to live in His sight. Always, always to walk in the Father. Thank Thee this day for loving kindness to show us the way. Grateful we praise Thee with songs of delight. Gladly, we'll walk in the light. Teach me to walk in the light.
Teach me to walk in the light. Teach me to walk in the
Hello, everyone. Welcome to this week's Walk in the Light event. My name is Elder Barron.
My name is Elder Palmer, and we will be tonight's hosts.
As we get the event started and people are joining in, let us know in the comments where everyone is tuning in from.
Tonight, we're joined by Meg Johnson. Meg has motivated people of all abilities with her motto, "When life gets too hard to stand, just keep rolling." Meg fell off a cliff and broke her neck in 2004 at age 22. She spent 4 months in the hospital recovering from multiple injuries and returning home without the use of her legs, back, stomach, or hands, a quadriplegic. Wheelchair bound and determined, Meg refuses to sit still.
However, before we introduce her too much more, we'd love to open tonight's event with an opening musical number by Emily and Sarah Steele. Following them, the opening prayer will be offered by Brother Basic, all of whom are members of the church living in the Hartford, Connecticut area.
Listen to His words, let them come alive. If we know Him as He is, there is peace in Christ. He gives us hope when hope is gone. He gives us
Heavenly Father, we are grateful to welcome Meg Johnson in this Walk in the Light session, and grateful for her contribution to the church and the gospel. And please be with us in our worship and service this day. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
That was amazing. Thank you so much. As we said before, tonight we are joined with Meg Johnson.
Since she was paralyzed, Meg has competed at the National Miss Wheelchair America pageant in New York, winning the Spirit Award, instituted a service outreach program, and authored several books. She received the 2012 Weber County Athena Award, which recognizes her service efforts. Meg and her husband, Whit Johnson, have two wonderful daughters.
Meg, the time is all yours.
Hello!
Hello!
Hi! I wanted you to meet my super cute girls. This is Daisy. You want to tell them how old you are? You do? Are you going to say it? Maybe you could hold it up with your fingers. No? Okay. She's 3. And then this is Zula. She's 3.5.
No, I'm not 3.5. I'm this old.
She's 10. And then this is Zula, and she's 7. And this is my husband. He didn't want to come in because he's not dressed very nicely. But this is Whit. So this is my happy family. Everyone look happy for the camera. Cheese! Okay, thanks so much, you guys. You guys don't have to stick around anymore. I did bring my one daughter, Zula, when she was 4. I took her with me to like a girls camp talk, and I was like, oh, she's old enough. She's going to love to come and be a part of this talk now. Like, she's old enough. She can listen to stories. She read she didn't read, but I read to her like Harry Potter books 1, 2, and 3 by the time she was 2 years old. Like, she has a great attention span. And so anyway, so I took her with me to the talk, and she afterwards, she's like, Mom, that was so boring. I guess I'm, you know, our kids, we need other people to teach our children. That's what it is. But I really wanted you to see my super happy family and how happy I am to have my happy family. So I'm a mom. And I'm a wife, and I'm a neighbor, and I'm a friend, and I'm a Relief Society teacher. And I'm also in a wheelchair, so I'll back up just a little bit so you can kind of see. Oh, I'm wearing pants. I probably should be wearing a dress, but there's actually no rules. Nothing in the Bible that says you have to wear a dress to give a fireside, especially from your house if it's virtual. Anyway, so here I am in my wheelchair. I am a C7 quadriplegic. I'm paralyzed from the chest down and my hands don't work. So this hand's had a little bit of surgery on it. I can like, you know, they took the tendons out of the back of the wrist and put them in the front. So every time I tip my wrist back, my hand closes and my thumb pinches. So the fingers are always curved on this hand. And then this hand's never had that surgery. So it's sort of wobbles and wiggles and does whatever it wants, you know, whenever it wants to. So those are my hands, and then my legs, you know, and my back is paralyzed and my tummy's paralyzed. Every once in a while, you'll see me twist a little bit like this or like this. It's because I have really low blood pressure, like 80 over 40. That's just natural. I mean, normal, I mean, just what I have. And so sometimes I get lightheaded still. And so I'll twist a little bit to like push the blood back up to my face so I don't pass out. You're welcome. Wouldn't that be so terrible if your speaker passed out, especially on like a virtual speech? You'd be like, where'd she go? Is this what she does? Maybe it froze. Like you wouldn't even know. So anyway, I just wanted to introduce myself and what I am and what I have. But I haven't always been like this. Like this is a spinal cord injury. I actually broke my neck. I've got like the scars. Got the scars to prove. I actually feel like I'm supposed to show you the scars. So I'm going to turn around like so and show you the scars. So I've got some family in here. Can you see the scars? Can you see them on the screen?
Yeah.
Okay. Maybe I just had to prove to you that legit I've got 27 screws and 2 silver plates and they're titanium. That's what they tell me. I don't know. I've never seen them in real life. But anyway, that's what I am. That's what I have. That's my body. But I live a very happy life. I have a wonderful, happy family. I have a happy heart. I have a happy mind. How do I stay so happy? I hope to get into that a little bit with you right now. But I want to tell you about how I used to be. And I was happy then too, but I was a walking me. And I was paralyzed in 2004 when I accidentally jumped off a cliff. I was hiking in St. George. I know one of our elder MCs is from St. George, so it's where his hometown is. And just outside is this box turtle preserve. And so I was out there, you know, hiking on these little red rock paths. It was my very first time to St. George. I'm not from Utah, and so I'd never even been there. And so I was hiking on this little red rock path, and at one point it forked. So my friend that I was with went one way. He was my boyfriend at the time. I didn't marry him, married my husband. And then I went the other way and I was jumping on all these boulders. And I saw this one last boulder and I jumped for it. And on accident, I just jumped off a cliff. What I didn't know about that area was that all of the red rocks and the red sand or the red dirt and everything make it all blend together. And so I didn't realize that I was even near a cliff. So anyway, that's what happened. That's why I'm paralyzed. I fell about 45 feet to the ground where they think I landed on hands and knees because I broke both my arms and both my legs, my collarbone, and 4 bones in my neck. And that was in 2004. And that was a long time ago. That was a really long time ago. A really long time ago for some of us. Some of you guys might be like, oh my gosh, I wasn't even born yet. But that was a long time ago. And a really long time ago, we didn't all have cameras and video cameras on our cell phones. Like we had flip phones and we were lucky if they took pictures at all. And so I was a dancer before I was paralyzed. I was on the Utah State Ballroom dance team. And then I did like some other types of dancing on some other teams and stuff. But the only video that I actually have of me dancing was right before I was paralyzed. And it was with my little brother. He was nominated for his high school mock beauty pageant. And he was Mr. ROTC because he was in the ROTC. And so he's like, oh, Meg, come and, you know, do a little dance with me. And so I was like, sure. So this is actually the only video I have of me dancing. And it's not even the type of dancing I did all the time. So this is swing. I just thought I would show you guys. I hope it works. I really hope it works. Actually, I don't see anybody to see if there's music there, but hopefully there is. It sounds exciting. He twirls like rifles and stuff. And so, anyway, so he was doing that for his ROTC. He's got on his fatigues, and he's really good, and he's really strong. Oh my gosh, he's so handsome. And so, here we go. I sincerely hope the music is playing. This is what I'm saying. That's me out there with broken legs. Not taking this. Check out my little brother's toe touch. He likes so much. Just give that rhythm. Everything you got on your head. Well, anyway, that is my little brother and me dancing. He, I guess we all grew up. He's a doctor now in West Virginia, and he's going to be moving back to St. George. So anyway, that was a long time ago, like a different lifetime ago when I was dancing on the stage, and I used chopsticks two different ways because I worked for a Vietnamese lady, and apparently there's a right and wrong way to do it if you're, you know, fancy over there. And so she taught me the right way to use it. And after I got paralyzed, like I couldn't use chopsticks anymore, and I couldn't dance anymore, and I couldn't even walk anymore, and I couldn't stand up, and I couldn't use my hands to do the things that I wanted to do. I remember my first Christmas back, it was torture because I couldn't even cut the wrapping paper to wrap the presents, and I couldn't tie the bows like I used to, and it was just so hard. The only job I ever wanted to be was a professional party planner, and that's what I was doing when I got paralyzed. And so there was no more decorating events, and there was no more, putting together party favors and stuff like that. At least at that time, it was just too hard. And so I came home from the hospital 4 months after I got paralyzed, and I had to sell my car. I used to drive a Toyota Corolla, but now I drive a Subaru Baja. If you don't know what a Subaru Baja is, it looks like a truck, and an El Camino had a baby. And so that's what I drive. They stopped making them in 2006. Hopefully that will change. I wrote to Subaru. I was like, I need another Baja. And so anyway, if you want, you can Google like how Meg Johnson gets out of her car. Oh, not missionaries, because you guys don't go to YouTube. But anyway, I can show you like a car transfer. Anyway, that's not important. But what I was going to say was I had to sell my car that I drove when I could walk. Like, it wasn't going to work for my wheelchair. I couldn't take it apart with my hands and pull it in. And so I had to sell it. And so all these people were coming over to look at it. And then this one guy came over to look at it, and I kept showing him my car, and he was not interested in looking at my car or anything about it. Except he just kept asking me questions. You know, he's like, so when were you paralyzed? Why are you selling your car? How did this happen? Who were you with? Where were you at? All of these different questions. And I'm like, no, just look at my car. You know, just look at my car. And, finally, we were talking, and we just kept talking, this long conversation, and he just cuts it, just stops talking about what we're talking about, stands there, folds his arms like this, looks down at me, and says, Meg, how can you still smile? How can you still smile? And this is the first time anyone had asked me this before. Since then, I've been asked this many times, but this was the first time. And I started to get like a little bit defensive. And in my heart, I was like, doesn't he know who I am? Doesn't he know how great my family's been? Doesn't he know about, you know, my boyfriend that I have? Doesn't he know about, you know, the fact that I can tie my own shoes and pick my own nose? Like, doesn't he know about all that, all those things I can do, and how hard I've worked to get to where I am right now, and how many things, you know, I have under my belt, all these talents that I have developed since I've been paralyzed? Like, doesn't he know that I can breathe by myself? And that was a hard thing to learn how to do, to relearn how to do. And all of this was boiling up inside me, and I opened my mouth to tell him just why I had cause to smile. But none of that came. And instead, what I said to him with as much passion as I had built up was, I have a testimony of Jesus Christ. And then I just looked at him, because that's not really what I meant to say. And he just looked at me, because that is not what he thought he'd hear. But I couldn't take it back. And I didn't want to take it back, because of all the things that I have that make me smile and all the things that I can do that make me smile, the only way that I can smile each and every day is because I have a testimony of Jesus Christ. I know that he created this earth. I know that he came to it. I know that he lived a sinless life, not just because it was easy for him, but because that's how strong he is. And I know that he atoned not just for my sins, but for anything that Isaiah says chastises my peace. And I can think of a lot of things that chastise my peace. And then I know that he gave his life, and I know that he took it up again and was resurrected and broke those bands of death so that I will be too. And I know that he lives. And because I know all that, I can smile. I can smile if I can walk. I can smile if I can't walk. I can smile if I can use chopsticks. I can smile if I can't. I can smile if I can dance. I can smile if I can't. It doesn't matter what happens to me or doesn't happen to me. I have a testimony of Jesus Christ, and that makes this life a happy life, knowing that this is for a bigger purpose than maybe what I see. Sometimes I think we think, oh goodness, all I want to do is be a good servant for Heavenly Father. All I want to do is serve him. All I want to do is what he wants me to do, but I can't because I have this trial. I can't serve him the way I want to because I have this family. I can't serve him the way I want to because I have this hardship, this disability, this struggle, this terrible thing in my life. All I want to do is serve Heavenly Father, but I can't because of this. I want to share something with you. I want to share that we are important to Heavenly Father. Elder Rasband says, sometimes we consider changes in our plans as missteps on our journey. He says, think of them as more first steps to being on the Lord's errand. I remember sitting in my wheelchair in front of a full-length mirror, looking at myself in my ragdoll body in a wheelchair, This was never something that I ever thought would ever happen to me. I mean, ever. I was so far removed from the wheelchair community that I didn't even know somebody who knew somebody in a wheelchair. And here I was, me, in a wheelchair, and I started to cry. And I thought, I'm never going to be able to teach my kids how to dance like I always thought I would. And then I started to cry even harder because I thought, well, maybe I'm not even going to have kids. Maybe I can't. And then I started to cry even harder because I thought, well, maybe the reason I'll never have kids is because I'll never find a husband who would want to marry me. And I started to cry just oh so hard. And then I started to pray, and I was mad. I was mad at Heavenly Father. I think sometimes having a testimony backfires because we know who to blame. And I was mad at him. And I said, Heavenly Father, why have you done this to me? Really? Why have you done this to me? I didn't do anything to you. I was just being normal. Average. Regular. Why have you taken away so much from me? And I probably didn't deserve it, but in his mercy, which by definition means undeserved, he answered me and chastised me, which I did deserve, and said, don't covet, because I have given you more. Corrie Ten Boom wrote a poem about a weaving. You see those little circle weaving things? It's like a picture, like they sew a picture onto like a circle piece of fabric. I forget what it's called. And so if you're good, it looks the same on the front as it does on the back, you know, when you turn it over. But if you're not so good, it's a little bit messy, a little bit thready, like with lots of threads going everywhere on the underside, and the top side looks like a nice picture. So just sort of imagine that for this poem. It helps it. She said, my life is but a weaving between my God and me. I cannot choose the colors. He worketh steadily. Oft times he weaveth sorrow, and I in foolish pride forget. He sees the upper, and I the underside. Not till the loom is silent and the shuttles cease to fly will God unroll the canvas and explain the reason why. The dark threads are as needful in the weaver's skillful hand as the threads of gold and silver in the pattern he has planned. I was in the hospital in the respiratory ICU, and you can probably see my trach scar right here. They told me it would like heal up like a little line, like a little scar that just went straight across, but they lied. It looks like a belly button. I was totally born again, like in 2004. And so anyway, so I was in the respiratory ICU for a while, but this actually happened later. For the majority of the time, the majority of the 4 months that I was in the hospital, I was actually intubated on a ventilator. And I know everybody knows what that means right now. And it was horrific. Like, it was terrible. I like have to take a deep breath every time I think about it. And so anyway, while I was there, I had a dream that I know wasn't a dream, but for lack of a better word, we're going to call it a dream. And in this dream, I saw myself sitting in heaven, and I knew I was looking at myself before I was born. And I was dressed in white, and I was sitting at this long table next to a man who was also dressed in white. I don't know who this man was. And between us on the table, we had papers. And I knew that this man was explaining to me what it was going to be like to be paralyzed. And I watched my little spirit self say to him, "Oh, I am so excited." I know that all of us had a similar experience when we were in heaven, where we were prepared and excited to come to this earth and experience not just those things that would make us happy, but we were excited to experience those things that would make us sad. We were just as excited to laugh as we were to cry, because the only way that you can know how good it feels to laugh so hard with your friends that you're not making any more noise, you know, that laugh where you just look like you're shaking because you're laughing so hard. The only way you can know how good that feels is if you have cried so hard that you're not making any more noise. There's no way that you could appreciate the one extreme if you've never made it to the other. And we were excited to experience all that this life had to offer. And we were excited to experience trials in this life, because the trials in this life enable us to accomplish our purposes in this life. When we take our talents and our strengths and our abilities and we gather all of those up to build the kingdom of God, we can't forget our trials and our struggles and our hardships, to gather those up too and serve with both our talents and in our weakness. Because Heavenly Father gives us talents and strengths to serve with, to serve other people with, but then he gives us trials and hardships to put us in the correct place in his kingdom. And that works for both ways. Sometimes our talents put us in the correct place in his kingdom to build it. But then often, and I think maybe more often, our trials put us in the right place. Over here in Utah, I know Massachusetts has it too, because when I went to Miss Wheelchair America, Miss Massachusetts was gorgeous. And then Miss Connecticut actually won when I went to Miss Wheelchair America in 2006. And so anyway, but I was Miss Wheelchair Utah then. And then when I came home, we didn't have a pageant here. And so I started it for adult women, and then teenage women wanted to come, and then little girls wanted to come. And those little girls, I mean, that just exploded. That's like its own pageant that we have now. It's like huge. Why would I do that? Why would I do that for my home state of Utah if I wasn't in a wheelchair? Like, why would I do that? Of course, Heavenly Father used my party planning talents combined with the fact that I'm in a wheelchair and I want to feel pretty to find those people who are in the same boat as me and serve them. Ulysses Suarez said, to follow the Savior's example, each of us must find those sheep who are facing similar circumstances and reach them and pick them up and help them proceed on their journey towards eternal life. That was Elder Suarez. We have an obligation to do this, and we have talents to serve other people and trials to serve other people. Now, let me get this like very clear. If you have a trial in your life that you can remove, you need to remove that trial from your life. Like, don't keep that around. But if you have trials in your life and talents in your life that, I mean, they're not going nowhere, and you put those together and you find someone to serve, you have discovered purpose for your life. Congratulations, you are accomplishing your mission in this life. I know a lot of you are currently on missions in this life, but you will forever be accomplishing missions and fulfilling purposes as you take your talents and you take your trials and you put them together and you find someone to serve. That is how you discover your purpose in this life. I taught high school seminary before I had children, and on the faculty, there was this guy, and he was really fit and strong, and his wife was the same way, and they ran those obstacle course marathons all the time, and they're really like fun couple, and he came up to me once, and he's like, Meg, I have to tell you, I used to be paralyzed. And I was like, what? And he explained to me that he contracted a virus in his neck, in his spinal cord, that paralyzed him from his neck down. Now, to give you an idea, I personally am paralyzed from my chest down. So I have the use of my arms. And anyway, so that's me. I have the use of my arms, but he didn't have the use of his arms. Like, he was just, his arms were down and he could move his head like this, you know, but that was it. He was being prepared to go home from the hospital in a sip and puff wheelchair. Sip and puff wheelchair has a straw that comes around to your mouth and you can suck and blow and maneuver it with your mouth so that your wheelchair goes where you would like it to go. And that's the wheelchair that he was being prepared to go home in the hospital from with. And three days. And I'm sure people fasted and prayed and gave him blessings and things like that, but nothing worked. And 3 days before he was released to go home from the hospital in a sip and puff wheelchair, he suddenly, inexplicably, and miraculously just stood up. Like, he could move his fingers, he could move his toes, he could dance all around. He's like, well, hope I don't see you later. You know, like, he just walked out of the hospital. He's like, I guess I'm gonna go home. Once he was at his home, he dropped to his knees. And he said, Heavenly Father, I am very grateful. I am very grateful for the fact that I can walk. I'm very grateful for this, but I just want to know why. Why did you heal me when so many other people in this life really are in wheelchairs? Why was I healed and they're not? I was not that I want to be there. I just want to know why. And he's braver than me. but Heavenly Father answered his prayer. And before I tell you what Heavenly Father said to him, I need you right now to think about the blessings that you have in this life, the strengths that you have. Yes, I'm sure a lot of you can walk, you know, but maybe you're great at math. Maybe you're great at dancing. Maybe you're great at party planning. What? Maybe you're great at organization. Maybe you're, I don't know what you're great at, but you do and God does. And if you don't know, he will tell you. I need you to think of those, the things that you're good at, the talents and strengths that you have right now, the gifts in your life. In the same thought, I need you to think of the trials in your life that you can't remove. Depression, anxiety. I don't know what's going on in your life right now. Maybe your parents got divorced. That's horrific. I don't know what's happening in your life right now, but you do, and so does God. And so think of both of those things when I tell you what Heavenly Father told my friend when he was on his knees asking, Heavenly Father, why did you heal me when you don't heal other people? Why did I get chosen to be healed? Because Heavenly Father said to him, like he would say to each one of us with our own individual details, he said, because for what I need you to do, I need you to walk. Heavenly Father has a purpose and a mission, lots of missions for each one of us. And we need these trials to give us perspective, to put us in unique parts of the kingdom that we wouldn't otherwise go. And then he gives us talents in addition to those trials so that we are prepared to serve and build the kingdom where he needs us. Sometimes that's not exactly where we want to go, but if we serve other people with everything we have, we will discover our purpose in this life and it will be so fun. I only have one more minute, but let me think. Let me look at all my stories. Maybe I'll close with this one right here. I want to share that The night my husband proposed, he proposed later on, but earlier on, he plays a Brazilian style of guitar called bossa nova. He served a mission in Brazil. And so we went up and he was playing with his group, you know, and it was this acoustic-y type music. And we were eating rice and beans because it was a, you know, Latin festival, super fun. And then my husband's group came and sat back down at our table, and then the music changed from like acoustic-y guitar, drums, maracas, to like a heavy system, like a beady music. And I felt it before I heard it, which I know sounds crazy because I'm paralyzed most of my body, but it came in through the floor and it vibrated up through my wheelchair and went straight into my heart. And I recognized it immediately as Latin dancing music. And my heart just sank. And I looked to the stage and sure enough, these two Latin dancers had come and taken the stage and they were dancing all around. And my eyes instantly filled with tears. And I thought, because that's the dancing that I used to do, was the Latin dancing. And I was on the Utah State ballroom team. I had won awards in that ballroom. And here I was in a wheelchair looking up at these two other people doing what I love. And I started to cry, but not really. They didn't like, they stayed, the tears stayed in my eyes. And if I just kept my eyes open, it just looked like I had allergies, you know? And I was looking at the stage and I was begging, and I think begging is a loaded word, and you understand it to the extent that you've done it. And I was begging Heavenly Father, please, 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 just one more time. Just let me get up and dance with them. I promise, I will not ask for anything as long as I live. Just let me get up and dance with them. And I'm not exactly sure what would have happened had Heavenly Father blessed me with the thing that I wanted at the time that I wanted it, you know? Just run up to the stage, you know, pushed her out of the way. May I cut in? Like, I don't know. So then I'd be like, hey, I think that girl just jumped out of a wheelchair. Like, hallelujah, you know, I don't know. But I didn't want to blink because if I blinked, the tears were going to fall, you know? So I excused myself to go out to the hallway and I found this big plant and I hid behind it and I cried. And I cried and I prayed and I said, Heavenly Father, I'm so sorry. I don't mean to be weak. I don't want to be weak. Will you please increase my faith in the plan of salvation? You guys know that song, I Know That My Redeemer Lives? And there's that line in there, he lives to wipe away my tears. As I prayed for more faith in the plan of salvation, truly the one who made it possible came and touched my heart in a way that took away all those tears. And I was able, which is a big word for me, to go back into that ballroom and not just watch those Latin dancers dance, but I was able to enjoy it because I know that this life is not all there is. I know that there is more after this life. There was more before. I know that there is dancing in heaven and there's all kinds of fun things after this life. And because I know that, it's okay. It's okay. Whatever happens in this life, and I can accomplish whatever mission Heavenly Father needs me to accomplish, because someday I'm going to see him and I'm going to see Jesus Christ. And on that day, I want to be able to not just stand up, but I want to be able to stand tall and be able to look them in the eyes and tell them I did what they asked me to do. And that day is a very important day for me to look forward to and motivates me to do what I have to do and be who Heavenly Father needs me to be and serve where he needs me to serve right now. And I say this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Wow. Thanks, Meg, for your awesome message. That was wonderful. We're super happy to have you with us tonight. We're going to jump right into the question and answer portion. A lot of viewers have been asking us questions, so we're going to pull the first one up. So the first one is, what are ways we can learn to keep humble during hard times and just hold on when they get even harder?
Oh, what are ways we can learn to be humble through hard times? Can we keep that question up? Would that be okay?
Sure.
Just so I can make sure that I answer the right question. Daxton Cox, what are the ways we can learn to keep humble during hard times and just hold on tight when they get even harder? I think it helps to understand that there's a purpose for all trials and that we can, that there's a reason not just to have the trial, but Heavenly Father said that he's going to prove us in all things. And so we shouldn't be afraid of our adversary because it just offers us another chance to prove to Heavenly Father the kind of strength we have in our character. When I was in the hospital in the respiratory ICU, I had the ventilator in my mouth and the feeding tube in my nose and the PICC lines in my arms and the tubes in my lungs. And I had, you know, I was tied to the bed and because they thought I had brain damage. And so they tied me up to the bed because they didn't want me to pull out the tube. So they tied my arms down. I had the metal halo in my head, you know, and of course I was paralyzed. And so to touch on your part of your question, like, how do we keep humble? I've heard that meekness is taking trials and swallowing them like horse pills. And the only thing I do, and that I can think of to say when we hit a trial and how to be humble, is to be grateful. And I learned that early on when I was all, you know, the tubes everywhere and the metal halo in that respiratory ICU. I woke up one day and I was all alone in my hospital room and I started to cry. And I didn't want to cry because I didn't know, but I didn't have anything else to do. I couldn't shake it off. I couldn't talk. I couldn't do anything. And so I was on my back and staring straight at the ceiling. And I said in my heart, Heavenly Father, please bless me with love for the ceiling. And I felt a little bit better. And then I looked out the window and I said, and bless me with love for that window and that car and that visitor's chair and the TV and the light switch and the bed and the blankets and the tubes. And I prayed for love for everything that I saw. And by the time I'd prayed for love for everything that I saw, I was crying again. Only I was crying because I was so happy. I had gone from being so sad to the point of tears to being so happy to the point of tears simply by loving everything that was around me. I think that's the fastest and best way to be humble, even when our life hits a trial, to just show Heavenly Father that we can be grateful for whatever happens, and we are just going to do what we have to do to get through this. So gratitude is my first step, even when you can't walk.
Thank you so much. That was a great answer, and I think that is so true, that gratitude and humility are very connected. Thank you for that answer. And we'll move on to our next question. And that's from Juliana Corbridge. And she said, how do overcome the overwhelming what if question?
That's a really good question, because there's a lot of what, like, oh my goodness, like, what if I would have known that the cliff was there? You know, what if the doctors could have been able to save me? What if I could have gone to the Craig Hospital in Colorado, which is where if you break your neck, you know, that's where they can fix you. You know, what if I didn't have lung damage? You know, would I have been able to leave the hospital sooner? The what if question will destroy you. Like, it will break you down, and it will cause you to just sit and mope and pine over what if. What if, what if, what if? A better question is, what is? What is happening? What is something I can do to serve someone else? What is going on right now? What is it that I can do? Like, what is so much better than what if. What if will kill you. What is will save you. And if you serve other people, this is magical. And I didn't even touch on service. Well, I mean, I touched on it a little bit, but I didn't really get into it too much. But if you can take the focus off yourself, for some reason, it's your own life that is what comes into focus. And so you cannot, absolutely cannot ask what if, but you can serve someone else. What if I serve someone else? That's a good what if question. And then your life will be the one that comes into focus, because this life doesn't make sense a lot of times. Why did this have to happen? Like, if only this happened differently, like, that's what we want. And it gets so confusing and hard to figure ourselves out. But as we take the focus off ourselves and put it on someone else, as we serve them, no matter who they are, that it's our life that comes into focus. I did it when I got out of the hospital. I served elementary school kids. And if you Google me, you can Google the video Falling Up. And it's a video they did on that story in particular. And it was that service to those elementary school kids, as I listened to them read their library book, that put my life into focus. Albert Einstein said that a person starts to live when he can live outside himself. The what if question keeps you in here. What if this happened? Oh my goodness. But as you serve someone else, you'll have a way better, way happier life.
I love that. That's great. Changing the what if to what is. That's an amazing answer. Thank you. So our next question is going to be pulled up. It's from Colton Gardner, and it says, you have an immaculate story. We live in a fallen world. Has any person ever erroneously mistreated you because of your current situation? If so, how did you react to such offense?
Yes, it's a reality that people do that to other people. And I think being in something about being in a wheelchair is I see the best of people and I see the worst of people. And it's really hard has anyone ever mistreated me? The answer to that is a big resounding yes, very, very, very often. But if I start to focus on that and if I start to complain about that or demand justification, that would consume my life. That would consume my brain. That would consume everything about me. So I choose instead to focus on those times when people didn't do that or they treated me right and just ignore the times that they didn't treat me right. Like one time I was in the young women's and one of the young women was pushing my wheelchair to the church building, but it was dark. And so she didn't know, but we hit like a little pothole. And so the front of my wheelchair like dipped inside the pothole and my whole person like fell out onto the ground. It was crazy. And I was like, oh my gosh. And we lived in kind of a ghetto. We lived in like a ghetto part of a ghetto city, you know? And this big, boomy, like really low to the ground car like drives really fast. This happened so fast. It's like, vroom, like right up next to us. And I was like, oh my gosh. And this giant man with a wife beater, like one of those tiny tank tops on, jumps out of the car. He's like enormous and he has a shaved head with tattoos on it. He like jumps out of the car and he starts coming at me. And I was like, oh my gosh, like I've got this 14-year-old young woman right with me. And I was like, oh my goodness. And he comes over to me, doesn't say a single thing, picks my wheelchair up and writes it on the ground, picks me up with the other hand and puts me in, pats me on the head and gets back in his car. And then he's like, rum, you know. It is those kinds of stories that I choose to focus on because the other would just consume my life. It would be too depressing. So I like those ones better.
Yeah, that's awesome. Thank you for that great insight on perspective and attitude. And our next question will be from Caden Stevenson. And he said, Meg, I feel like a lot of people put in your situation would stay frustrated with Heavenly Father. How did you gain the courage to still choose to follow him?
That is true. That is very, all of these have been insightful questions, but this one particularly is a very real thing. When people's lives hit trials, you form a relationship with God. You do. Everybody does. Whether it's a good one or a bad one is entirely up to us as individuals. But you do. You form that relationship with God because you need something to make sense out of this terrible thing that has happened in your life. And so you form that relationship with God and you can choose. Everybody gets to choose if they form a good relationship with him or a bad one. And every trial offers you the same question, the same decision, whether you will move toward God or away from him. Like you're going to go one direction. When you hit a trial, you are going one direction. In fact, every single day, this podcast or this video, this experience that we're on is called Walk in the Light. Every moment of every day, you are taking steps spiritually. You are either walking toward the light or you are walking toward the dark. Every single moment of every single day is a step in one of those two directions. Bigger steps happen when bigger things happen. And when we choose to walk toward the light, we will discover more happiness. Even if we have no more understanding, we will discover more happiness as we choose to face Jesus Christ and Heavenly Father and go toward the light, walk in the light, even if you can't even walk, than you would if you walk toward the dark. That just is. So I would consider this trial of being paralyzed when I was 22 years old when I got paralyzed, and I would consider this to be a Goliath trial. This was a big trial in my life. It wasn't the biggest, but it's a big trial in my life. The story of David and Goliath is very interesting to me because the backstory to it. Because when David sees Goliath, he's like, why is nobody fighting this guy? Like, what's everybody's problem, you know? And why is he so like confident that he, and when he fights Goliath, he's like, I don't need any shield or armor. Like this is, and he goes to the brook and how many stones does he get to use in his slingshot? 5. He is so confident in fighting Goliath that he knows he can get him in 5 tries. And so why is he so confident? why, how did David become so confident? And so if you read back a little bit in that same chapter, you discover the reason. Because what was his occupation before he was, you know, king and this warrior? He was a shepherd for his father's sheep. And while he was a shepherd, do you remember, it reads in the Bible that his flock, his sheep were attacked twice, once by a bear and once by a lion. And he beat those, both of them, with his bare hands. So when he saw Goliath, he's like, I'm going to kill you too. Whenever we get Goliath trials, we need to think back. When was my bear? When was my lion? Because God does not give you a Goliath trial without giving you a bear and without giving you a lion. When I was paralyzed, I remembered one of my lions. When I was 18 years old, I graduated from high school. I was so excited. I got accepted to go be a nanny in Germany. I said goodbye to my high school boyfriend, and he was going to go on a mission soon. We were going to get, you know, back together after he served a mission, and I went to Germany to be a nanny, and then we were going to get married. We were going to make babies. They were going to be trilingual. We had a plan. And so I went over to Germany, and there's a lot of great people that have good personalities that make great nannies. I'm just not one of those. So I was there for 5 days, and they're like, Meg, we are sending you home. They took me to the airport and they dropped me off. I came home after being in Germany for 5 days. I was so sad, being kicked out of a foreign country. I called my boyfriend. I was like, I'm so sad, you know, and he had another girlfriend whom he had kissed. I was gone for 5 days. Like, he couldn't wait for me for 5 days. I'd never been so sad in my entire life. I laid on the floor of my bedroom in fetal position, crying like a little girl. I cried so hard that I made myself throw up, ran to the bathroom, came back, laid down, cried some more, smelling like vomit and soaked in my own tears. I mustered the only prayer I could muster. And before I tell you what it is, I'll tell you about my choice. Because I had a choice to turn toward God or turn away from God. Because this is a big step. I'm either going to step real big into the light or real big into the dark. Because I had been kicked out of Germany and dumped. Both of those by themselves are really bad trials. And so I guess, and fired and then kicked out of the country. Anyway, so I had a friend at the time, and she had a similar experience. I mean, she wasn't kicked out of a foreign country, but she had been dumped. And that was a big trial for her. And she formed a relationship with God. And instead of walking into the light, she said, because God let my boyfriend dump me, he must not exist. He would never hurt me like this. So she stepped into the dark. I didn't know that 20 years later, she would be on her third marriage with children from multiple different dads, trying to quit smoking unsuccessfully with a husband and her, and they both can't stop drinking alcohol, and I'm not even sure they're trying anymore, leading a terribly unhappy life. I didn't know that was her 20 years later. I didn't know. All I knew, as I was laying on the floor in fetal position, smelling like vomit and soaked in my own tears, was that in a clearer mind, her decision didn't make sense. And so I wanted to blame God. I wanted to blame him. I forgot who said this. You can Google it. But he said, God is forsaken in the all too human yet mistaken fear that he has forsaken us. And so I knew that I didn't want to blame God, but I really, really, really did want to blame God. Like, this trial was horrific. Like, I wanted to step into the dark. I wanted to be mad at God. I wanted to blame him. I wanted to turn my back on him because it felt like he turned his back on me. But I didn't. And I tried to take the baby steps that I could toward the light. And in fetal position, laying on the floor, I said the only prayer I could muster. I said, Heavenly Father, please don't let me blame this on the church. Please don't let me blame this on the church. Please don't let me blame this on the church. And that next Sunday, I made myself get up and go to church. I didn't want to. But I was there and I went to the first class. That's way back when church was 3 hours long. I don't know if you can remember. But I went to my first class and they're like, Meg, we're going to ask you to be the chorister for this class. And I'm like, okay, thanks. And then I went to the second class and the bishop pokes his head and he's like, Meg, we are not going to release you from your young single adult calling in the church. I'm like, thanks. After the third class, the stake president pulls me in. He's like, Meg, we're going to ask you to be the young single adult president for the stake. I'm like, thanks. Before I could leave the church building, the bishop calls me into his office, sits me down, says, Meg, we're going to ask you to direct the ward road show. I went home from church that day with four callings and a testimony that when you're sad, Heavenly Father needs you to serve. And by immersing yourself in the gospel, you will maintain your testimony and maintain those baby steps in the light. Serving in those four callings did not take away the pain of being dumped or the pain of being kicked out of foreign country. It didn't take away that pain, but it did provide an opportunity to strengthen my testimony and keep me in the light. That was my lion. And that's what I remembered as I was sitting in my wheelchair, freshly paralyzed. And I thought, I learned then when I was 18 that when you're sad, Heavenly Father needs you to serve. And that's why after I got paralyzed, I asked my mom to push me down to the elementary school where I volunteered with the elementary kids. And that is what saved me. The hospital fixed me, but it's serving that healed me. And it's serving other people that put my life in focus and allowed me to take baby steps into the light and discover a purpose for this trial and other trials I've had in my life. As I serve other people, I discover the purpose for this trial. And that is how you can maintain a good relationship with Heavenly Father when bad things happen, because bad things will continue to happen. And you must take those baby steps toward the light always and choose that good relationship. Okay, that was, I always have long answers.
No, that was wonderful. Thank you. It's true. Like, service is one of the best ways to get ourselves out of our feelings, I guess you could say, or to stop pondering on them. So that's amazing. We're going to pull up our last quick question, and that is from Floyd Thompson, and it says, what has helped Meg maintain a humorous and gratifying life when it appeared the odds were against her?
That is, I feel very blessed. What has allowed Meg to maintain a humorous and gratifying life when it appears the odds are against her? Maybe it's because I really do feel like the odds are against me sometimes. And in fact, I have people who say to me, Meg, weird things happen to us when we're with you. like weird things don't happen to us when we're not with you. They only happen to you. I know that's not true. I know weird things happen to everybody. But I was pushing my wheelchair, going to the temple. I wanted to go serve. I believe you can serve people who are alive, and I believe you can serve people who are dead. And I was serving people who are dead this day, and I was pushing my wheelchair to the temple, but the sidewalk was at an incline, so I was rising, you know, going up to the temple like this. Floyd, I just can't stop thinking about your name. You got the coolest name ever. I'm so glad you asked this question. So I'm pushing my wheelchair up this. It's not steep, but I'm a pansy, so, you know, there's that. And so I'm pushing like as hard as I can up this sidewalk, and the wind is like against me. The wind is against me, not just like blowing at me, but it feels like it hates me. And it's blowing so, so, so hard. And I'm like, pushing my wheelchair as hard as I can. As I can. And I'm going like centimeters. I'm not even going to describe it as inches. Like centimeters every single time. Like I can't even like get this. This is so hard. And I really felt personally attacked by the weather that day as I was going to the temple. And I was thinking like, oh my goodness, like seriously, like can't Heavenly Father like make this wind stop? Like what is going on? Like, doesn't he want me to serve in the temple? Like, doesn't he know he paralyzed me and now he's like gonna push the wind at me? Like what is going on? I felt like the adversary was just, Heavenly Father allowed the adversary to maneuver the wind and to attack me with this like terrible wind on the hill going to the temple. I believe in my heart of hearts that the adversary will make it difficult to do things that are good. And that is how we know if something is good. That is one of the ways that you can tell. I mean, of course, you're going to feel the Holy Spirit speaking to your heart. But if problems happen, if things arise, like I really actually did plan to wear a dress today, but things kept happening. And so I didn't actually change into a dress for this fireside. And that was one of the things that I'm like, well, I guess there's a lot of trial going before this fireside. Like the adversary really doesn't want this to happen. So I guess it's a good thing. And that's how I keep a good attitude about those bad things that happen, because I know that they're actually, you're only going to encounter the bad things on your way to the good things. Because the adversary doesn't stop you from walking into the dark. In fact, the easiest day I ever had was I was driving to a meeting about the Utah's first Golden Globes. I got invited to like this really fancy event and I was going to go meet with somebody before we went. It was so prestigious and it was like black tie and so fancy. And I had nothing against that at all. But I was going to a meeting before this thing and my life was like a cakewalk. I was like, oh my gosh, like nothing bad has happened to me this whole morning. And it was so refreshing. It was so refreshing. And I got there and I had the meeting and then I went home and then I thought about it and I'm like, you know what? Heavenly Father really just, like, there's nothing spiritually edifying about what I was embarking on. There's nothing that was going to save people's souls. There's nothing that was going to uplift people's spirits about what I was embarking on. And so the adversary had no problem with me doing it. Like, sure, like, go have this meeting. So the better something is, the harder it is to do it. And so anyway, I don't know if that helps you, but it sure helps me, like, to know that that's happening.
Yeah, that was a great response. Thank you. And you had a great message and we've had a lot of great questions and a lot of great answers, but we're going to close things out tonight, and we'll close them out with hearing a musical number from the Nixon family and a closing prayer by Isaac Smith.
We have been born as Nephi, to godly parents who love the Lord. We have been taught and we understand that we must do as the Lord commands. We are as the army of human. We have been taught in our youth.
Dear kind, gracious Heavenly Father, we are grateful for the opportunity to have participated in this Walk in the Light devotional, and we're grateful for Meg Johnson and the lessons that she's conveyed, and please bless us that we'll be able to apply them in our own life and use those lessons to be able to improve ourselves and set out to become better people. We're grateful for thee, Heavenly Father, and we say these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Well, awesome. Thank you, Meg, for all of your help tonight. It's been great having you. Do you have any last words for our viewers?
Any last words for your viewers? I have, I don't know. How long? Just a couple words?
No.
Let's see. The truth is true.
That's perfect. Yeah. That's perfect. Well, we really appreciate you coming out tonight and helping us out. We just want to invite everybody who's watching that if anybody has had questions about anything discussed, please make sure to send a message to the page, and we'd love to answer them to the best of our abilities.
Make sure to tune in next week for the next event, and have a great night.
See you, everybody.